Hello, it's 11 o'clock. As we have a lot of interesting material, I propose we start. So, first of all, it's for me a pleasure to be sponsor for this lecture and to introduce Maurizio. I know Maurizio Vretener since a long time. He actually started in this very building as a fellow, we will not say when, long time ago, doing RF and beam dynamics on low energy accelerator. He went on, come in, no worries. Over there. He moved on to bigger and bigger responsibility, and I cannot detail them all. The one more relevant to the lectures today is he has been project leader of LINAC4, and he's currently co-study leader of PIMS2. He's always been interested and very active in reaching out to society, to the world. And so he's the best person to talk to us about medical accelerator, the best person I could find at least, to talk to us about medical accelerator. So the lecture will be about some 50 minutes, and we suggest you keep all your questions at the end. And I realize a lot of you don't have a seat. There are some seats over here. Don't.
Three here and three there. So
Yeah, some
six
more.
people can come here.
You see, he's an organizer. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Alessandra. Can you hear me? Yes. Okay, so good morning. As Alessandra said, I mean, many of you know me from another context, LINAC4, because I'm relatively new in the field of medical accelerators. So I've been working on some medical projects a few years ago, but only since a couple of years I'm approaching this new and very interesting field. So, in a sense, my point of view will be the point of view of a newcomer in the business. And might be partial at some moment, but at least I think it's something that I would like really to share with you what I've learned in the last years that I've been spending thinking mainly on medical accelerators. Okay, accelerators for medicine. First of all, do you know how many particle accelerators there are in the world? More than 30,000. This is something that usually we don't think that our wonderful scientific tools are just a small minority of the many uses that you can have of particle accelerators. What we use for science is less than 1%, just the tip of the iceberg, but most of accelerators are used for industry and for medicine. Medical applications include more than 15,000 accelerators, so it's really a large number. And what I want to discuss with you is also to understand where these accelerators are and how they are used. But to go into that, we have to go first of all through a small classification of accelerators for medicine. So this is just a sort of a cartoon that I've done to understand what are the different applications and how many accelerators there are in the different fields. So when you produce a beam with your accelerator, you have a number of choices. The easiest is just to shoot directly your beam into a person, into a body, into a tissue, to use your primary beam. And then you can decide whether you use protons, ions, or electrons, that are the easiest particles to accelerate. If you use protons, you make proton therapy. If you use ion, you use ion therapy, and the two go under the common name of hadron therapy. There are about 75 accelerators in the world nowadays for hadron therapy. Or you can shoot electrons. And there is a use of electrons, direct radiation with electrons, which is called IORT, interoperation radiation therapy, around 300 machines installed in hospitals around the world. And there is some people now studying the possible use of very high energy electron for therapy. No operating accelerator for the moment, it's just a study. Okay, but you can also use a secondary beam. So you can send your primary beam on a target, and you can produce secondary beams of X-rays, photons, or neutrons. And this is the widest use of accelerators for medicine, is X-rays for radiation therapy. And is where we found about 14,000 machines installed around the world in most of the hospitals for radiation therapy. There is also a small use for neutron therapy, only 7 installations. This is quite old. I mean, nowadays everybody moved to protons or ions, but there are still 7 machines working for neutron therapy, but this is just using secondary beam. Then there is another option. You can just delay the radiation. You can produce on your target radioisotopes that then can be transported to the hospital and injected into the patient. It's a kind of delayed use of the products of the accelerator, and this is used for imaging or therapy. Those are the two main uses of for imaging, mainly for positron emission tomography, and for therapy, local irradiation of a tumor. And also you will see in my last slide that nowadays it's possible to combine the two in what is called theragnostics, combining therapy and diagnostics. There are 3 more seats here on the front, two here. I'm just doing also the theater manager. 2 here, another there, so if you wish. Just, I mean, don't be shy. I mean, if you circulate, it's not a problem. Just take a seat, and there is a seat there, if you wish. Okay, so total about 16,000 particle accelerators operating for medicine. Why, I mean, are we using so much the accelerators? It's a part of, let's say, of a general vision, a dream, let's say, of doctors, that of bloodless medicine, bloodless surgery. The idea is that to find a tool to penetrate into a body without the need to cut, to open, without blood. And this is the idea of using particle beams for both treatment and imaging without opening the patient. This is something which is very important, and this is the basis of what is called nuclear medicine, is the basis of radiation therapy. And if you only think of nuclear medicine, which is a use of isotopes for therapy and for the imaging, this is something you have about 16 million nuclear medicine procedures per year only in the US. So it's really something which is very widespread everywhere. Medicine and the accelerators, that also is important to underline, is there since the very beginning of accelerators. So the idea of using accelerators for medicine is at least as old as the accelerators are, because modern accelerators were built exactly 90 years ago, in 1928. Rolf Wiedereux was a PhD student at Aachen, and for his thesis, he invented the principle of radio frequency acceleration. And immediately, the year after, the idea went to Berkeley, where Ernest Lawrence studied the construction of the first cyclotrons. And from the very beginning, in the first cyclotrons that he was building in the 30s, he produced radioisotopes for many applications, and in particular for medicine and for treatment. And there is an interesting story that these were the most advanced machines in the world, the first cyclotrons by Lawrence. And the nuclear physicists were really putting a lot of pressure to do more and more experiments of these machines. And Lawrence said, no, we have to work at least 50% of the time for medicine, for isotopes, for the society, because our goal is to build larger and larger cyclotrons. And to get the public support to go to larger machines, we need to show that the use that our machines are useful for society, which is a very interesting vision that maybe we have lost a little bit now, I think, with the modern accelerators. Okay, and Lawrence cyclotron in 1939 started the first irradiation with neutrons, direct irradiation of tumors with neutrons, because it's what they had in the first cyclotrons. And this started in 1939, but it was in 1936 that Robert Wilson, the founder of Fermilab, had the idea of using protons to treat patients, to treat tumors, profiting of the Bragg peak. And this is something that we will see later. And this brought to the construction of the first proton treatment center in the US in 1990. So, a long history, and it is very much related to treating of cancer. Treating of cancer, which is the main goal, let's say, of accelerators for medicine, which has always been a high priority, but will become even more a priority in the near future, because nowadays already cancer is the second leading cause of death globally, and the incidence of cancer in the world population is going to increase. Not because the cancer is worse. Our medicine is better and better in curing cancer. The point is that we are living longer. And living longer lives, you reduce, you eliminate the other causes of death, and the incidence of cancer is higher. This is problem number one. Problem number two is in the developing countries, where also the age, while the age, let's say, the overall age is almost saturating now in our developed countries, the age is increasing in developing countries, so more cancer, but also worse environmental conditions. Pollutions, smoke and less healthy habits that bring that, those are the forecasts for the evolution of cancer in the world, and in particular in less developed countries over the next 20 years. So, and to treat cancer, nowadays the standard procedure is to go in three steps. Number one is surgery. Number two after surgery is radiotherapy. Radiotherapy that can be done with an accelerator and producing X-rays or with a hadron therapy machine. And number three is chemotherapy. And only now immunotherapy is starting as a fourth avenue to treat cancer. Okay, before going into the details of how accelerators contribute to medicine, I have to start with two key messages. Number one, what I have learned, let's say somehow at my expenses over the last months, is that accelerators for medicine are different from what we know in our scientific environment. Because, okay, for us, reliability is very important, beam stability is very important, but for them, it is much more important than what it is for us. So when you are treating a patient, there is a responsibility in operating a medical accelerator that is something that makes a lot of difference from what we are used in our scientific environment. So to give you an idea, I was talking with the CEO of a company that builds control systems for accelerators. And he told me, yes, for me it's very easy. The difference between a medical accelerator and a scientific accelerator is a factor of four. Factor of four in the complexity of the control system and factor of four in the cost. This because you have to obey to strict requirements that are certified, so there is a licensing process, quality assurance control that is related to any medical treatment. This is something that is much different from what we are used. So we are very controlled at CERN, but there, I mean, it's really a different world. So this is something that one has to consider in this respect. And you see that this is an example from IBA, a company in Belgium. This radiopharmaceutical production center that they can sell turnkey to produce radioisotopes for imaging. And you see the accelerator is a small synchrotron in a bunker here, but all the rest is the radiopharmaceutical part that is meant to produce the radioisotopes to be delivered to the hospitals and to follow to respect all the procedures. So really the accelerator is a small part of a large and complex installation. This is something that we have to understand. If you want to optimize, you have to optimize not the accelerator itself, but the overall process. The second discussion is about radiation management. Because medical exposure is a critical issue. It's a kind of a dilemma because on the one hand, medical accelerators are there to irradiate people and to give a dose which is in the right window. So there is an optimum window. If you give too low a dose, it is not effective. If you give too high a dose, you kill the patient or something like that. And so you have to really to shoot the target very precisely of the optimum dose. And this is really, it's very complicating, it's a challenge in itself, let's say, that has to be respected whenever you use accelerators for medicine. And also, you have to understand that there is a dilemma because on the one hand, delivering a dose to the patient is accepted because it is for his health. So, so if you compare risk and benefit, in the medical environment, they are quite used to give strong doses to the patients that for us at CERN are almost inconceivable. But on the other hand, the medical personnel that is working in the hospital, they have strict regulations that are exactly the same. They have the same dose limits that we have in the scientific world. So you have to find a good balance between these two requirements. And to give you an example, if you look at imaging, for example, with radioisotopes, so in some cases, you can give doses of up to 30 millisieverts to a patient for a single scan, CT scan of abdomen and pelvis, double scan. So if you think that the yearly dose, maximum yearly dose at CERN is 20 millisievert, you see that this is something that is already something quite high. So some time ago, I had to go through a coronary angiography. It was completely useless, by the way, but it was foreseen by the protocol. And so I brought home 8 millisieverts. That is about as much more than what I've got in all my career at CERN. So this is only in one day at the hospital. So, I mean, so it is safer to work at CERN than to go to the hospital. This is the conclusion. Okay, now let's go a bit through all the different applications of accelerators for medicine. And I want to start from the largest one, from the application for radiation therapy. Also because this will be a comparison term for what we are going to see for hadron therapy. Radiation therapy, so this is the most successful accelerator. It looks like something like that, that can turn around the patient. And inside this object, there is a small linear accelerator, a copper structure made of accelerating cells at 3 gigahertz, not much different from many Linux that we have at CERN, for a length of about 1.5 meters that accelerates electrons between to an energy up of from 5 for tumors close to the surface to 25 MeV if you want to really to penetrate inside the body. So it's small, it's compact, the electrons are sent to a tungsten target where the X-rays are produced. All around you have the typical components that we have in every accelerator at CERN. So a power supply, an RF supply, magneton or klystron, a modulator, power supplies, electron gun. So it's really a small and compact accelerator. And there are about 14,000 in operation worldwide for that. This is used for irradiating tumors. And if you see an example here of an in-depth tumor, irradiated from different sides in such a way that the dose accumulates on the tumor and it reduces the dose on the surrounding tissues. Use of this kind of linear accelerators for medicine is very popular, and there are many developments were done, especially in the last years, to improve the performance of these systems. Now they are using multi-leaf collimators, wonderful collimators, sliding metal plates, really, that allow really to shape the beam exactly with the shape of the tumor that they are going to irradiate. They are going to use they are combining imaging and therapy on the same machine, so you can get an imaging of your tumor and then the treatment. So there is a lot of work that is going to be done, not on the accelerator, but on the delivery system, to optimize the delivery system to the accelerator. As I told you before, it's an overall system that has to be optimized, not only the accelerator. And so this is the accelerator. The accelerator is a well-known type of structure because most of linear accelerators for therapy use the side-coupled structure. It is a type of LINAC that, by the way, for a moment, we even consider to use for LINAC 4. Then we discard it for another option, the side-coupled LINAC, which is well known for being very stable and very reliable. So again, the point is not performance, it's more stability and cost as well. And it's a wonderful example of technology that went out of a scientific laboratory into medicine, because originally this type of structure was developed in Los Alamos end of the 60s for the Los Alamos Meson factory. So the goal was just the first Meson factory, 800 MeV, I think, overall energy, total energy for protons in Los Alamos. And then slowly it took years for this technology to be, first of all, reduced in size, going to increasing the frequency to 3 gigahertz to reduce the size of this structure, to use it for electrons. And it's only from the 80s that really this was applied to medicine. This brought into the boom of this type of treatment. So technologies can go from basic science to the medical world, but it takes years and years of improvement in terms of reducing cost and size. One more remark about radiation, conventional radiation therapy worldwide. Here you have a slide taken from the material of the Enlight network that shows the density of radiation therapy machines in the world, the blue points, as compared to all the type cobalt sources that were the old solution before the invention of the linear accelerator for treatment of radiation treatment of tumors. And you see that in many developing countries, still all the cobalt sources are used, and there are a lot of white areas where people have no access to radiation therapy. This why, not only because of the cost, but because the wonderful, sophisticated instruments that are produced by the suppliers of radiation therapy systems do not work in harsh, difficult environments, like, for example, in Africa, where you have electrical breakdowns, you have dust, you have extreme heat and humidity. And even when some machines came as a gift from some organization to some, for example, countries in Africa, they work for a few months, and then they break down, nobody is able to repair them, and then they stay there idle. So there is, I wanted just to show you that there is, now an idea is started, and I'm proud of the fact that CERN is part of it, the idea of developing a new concept of radiation therapy accelerator for low and middle income countries. So this is the main idea, to try to see if one can develop a more robust structure, a more robust also environment, a radio accelerator that can really survive in a difficult environment of developing countries and possibly will be less expensive than normal machines. So there is an initiative launched by an NGO, a US NGO, which is called International Cancer Expert Corps, and there's now a collaboration where the main partners are CERN and STFC from the UK going this direction. So there have been already a number of workshops, and we are quite optimistic that something interesting could come out of this initiative, although one will have to compete in a sense with the existing market of the leading companies selling this type of accelerators worldwide and not really interested in changing their design. So they have their business model running, and so there will be at a certain moment an economical considerations will have to be taken. Okay, and now let's go to hadron therapy. Hadron therapy, which is one of the central subjects, let's say, of today's presentation, where people is really, if you think to the vision, to the idea of the bloodless surgery, then the ideal tool is the BreakPeak. The beauty of the BreakPeak is due to the fact that in the well-known beta block equation for energy lost by a particle crossing a material, a medium, we see that the energy loss is proportional to 1/2 the square of the velocity of the particles. So at the beginning, the particles are very fast, they deposit less energy, and so as they are slowed down, they deposit more and more energy. Then other phenomena enters into effect that increase this loss of energy in the final part of the trajectory to create a sort of resonance, which is the BreakPeak. Here you see in red the energy loss, which is proportional to the relative dose deposited inside the human body for 180 MeV protons. 180 MeV protons, so you see very low the loss of energy at the beginning, and then when they are around 15, 20 centimeters inside the body, you start losing more and more energy until you have the maximum loss here, and then what is also wonderful is just a sharp decrease in the dose. So there is almost nothing, they say nothing left above 25 centimeters. This really is magic, in a sense. It's wonderful. And this is the original idea by Bob Wilson, to use this peak for treatment of tumors. Of course, the reality is a bit more complicated than a pure formula. So first of all, because a tumor is not just a slice, you have a certain depth. So you have to change the energy of your beam if you want to scan through a tumor. Then you have to change it to scan the energy of your beam, and you have to go to make a spread out break peak. So you have to make different irradiations at different increasing energies, and so your overall dose will look more like this one, green, than the red one. So with some dose that goes in this part of the the body. Yes, but still you are much, much better than you are with photons. This is X-rays, and you see that X-rays, they tend to lose the maximum energy next to the surface, and then even after the tumor, they keep going through. So you have really a large dose that is left after the tumor. Okay, so a wonderful tool. You have nevertheless to go through the entire body, and so the energy that you need, the maximum energy you need, is what you need to go into the deep-seated tumors, and taking 33 centimeters in water, it means 230 MeV. It's for protons, is the energy, maximum energy that you need for a proton treatment machine. Currents are very small compared to what we use here at CERN or for scientific experiments. It's 10 nanoamps for a typical dose of 1 gray to 1 liter in 1 minute. So it's really something which is very, 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 very low. But you have to go to a relatively high energy. So to give an example, LINAC-4 is 160 MeV. So you need a machine that is, in principle, longer than the 100 meters of LINAC-4 if you want to bring the particles at that energy. And it's a pity because you make a huge investment in building a huge machine for only 10 nanoamps, which is, for me, just kind of it's a pity. LINAC-4 can make tens of milliamps, in a sense. So you see, so it's a different type of machines. So you have to find an optimum way to go high in energy with low currents. Okay. Nevertheless, it's always, I mean, proton hadron therapy is always to be compared to radiation therapy. And radiation therapy, you see that this is an example of a treatment of a prostate cancer with X-rays here to the right and with protons to the left. With X-rays, you need to enter from different positions, and you get this dose outside of the cancer. With protons, you can just irradiate only from two positions, thanks to a spread out Bragg peak, and you deliver your dose much more precisely. Similarly, here I have an image of a skull cancer that is treated here with X-rays and here with protons, and you see how cleaner is the treatment with protons. So great. So did we get the ideal tool for treating cancer? Yes and no, because things are a bit more complicated, as we will see. Nevertheless, this is really a booming application, because if you look at the number of particle therapy facilities in operation and in planning stage, we go from about 70 now to 130 foreseen around the world in the next future. But then there are already signals that somehow we go into a saturation, that already the orders for new proton therapy machines already this year in 2017 were not as high as expected, and many companies are revising now down their strategies. Because, it's a booming market, but already there were some signals, because some of you will remember that Siemens entered the particle therapy market with a lot of money, made big investments, until eventually in 2011, they went out of this market. They stopped completely any development for particle therapy machines. So, great. So do we have the wonderful tool, but why there is no more demand for particle therapy? So here, okay, so this is now how many parts. So now in Europe we have 8 centers in construction, 13 operation. But here I have some ideas on why, where, let's say my personal, what I've learned in the last months and what are the limits, let's say, of particle therapy. Number one, of course, is the cost. If you have to compare that, if you want to build the minimum proton therapy center, you can buy a turnkey proton therapy center for as low as 30 million euros. Single room, so you cannot do much in terms of, you cannot treat many patients, but it's just the entry price for proton therapy. And this has to be compared to 2-3 million, which is the cost of a radiation therapy machine. So there is a factor of 10. And this factor of 10, of course, has to be justified. So we have to justify what are the advantages of particle therapy with respect to radiation therapy. And this is even worse if you go to an ion therapy center, because ion therapy, if you want to do ion therapy, then you are in the range of 150, 200 million euros, so almost a factor 100 in terms of cost with respect to conventional radiation therapy. So There is an advantage, but it has to be justified, and there is a lot of pressure from the health insurance companies that are trying to break, I mean, to push the brake and to stop, I mean, to just to slow down the evolution of medical costs towards more sophisticated treatments. So nowadays, if you want to have the support from the health insurance systems, you really need to show that there is a real benefit with respect to radiation therapy. So don't worry, in the next slide, you will see that there is a real benefit, but for some cases, so we have to separate. We don't have the panacea that can treat everything, but we have something that is very good for very special cases. But it should not, it cannot be used for reasons of cost for all cases. The point number two is the effectiveness, because basically, I mean, everything is based on the Bragg peak, which is something that we physicists, we like a lot, because we always think in terms of energy. So the idea that you lose energy somewhere is something that we see very well. But the physiology is much different from physics. There are many more effects that happen inside the body when you deposit your dose, and there are many transfer functions between the energy deposition and the effect on the patient that are not completely mastered, they're not well understood, and that, in fact, there is still a lot of work to be done. And in fact, what happens is that if you treat with protons, the net effect is not much different than from conventional radiation therapy. Radiobiological effect is the same, the effect is the same, so there is not really an advantage. As we will see, there is an advantage with ions, but definitely not with protons. So basically, if you apply the same dose, the effect is the same, there is no difference in the treatment with photons, X-rays, or with protons. Where there is an effect is the fact that you don't irradiate the other organs. And so you spare the surrounding tissues, and there is a clear difference in the quality of life. So the fact that you spare the other organs make a better life to a patient that has been treated with particles with respect to X-rays. But the problem is that the quality of life is not a quantity that is easy to measure. It's not easy to publish. It's not easy to publish a scientific paper based on the evolution of the quality of life. They think in terms of mortality. The parameter is mortality, but the quality of life is not a parameter that you take into effect. Yes. And only now people is slowly starting to consider, take into account the quality of life due to the fact that you have not damaged other organs that will continue to function even after the treatment. So then optimization is also a point. I mean, the radiation therapy with X-rays is there since more than a century, and there's been a lot of progress in the optimization of the treatment, in the delivery, while it is still starting, the optimization of the delivery with protons and with ions. So there is still a lot of work to be done, which makes that there is space for improvement, but at the moment, the results are not particularly different. And then another point is centralization of medicine. Because of the cost, you have to make big centers because they have to be economically viable. So you have to start sending patients from faraway places to the treatment center, which is not at all easy. It's not easy for medical reasons, because these people sometimes cannot travel so easily. You have to move also parents and families, and also the doctors are not very supportive of sending their patients. The patient is their patient, and it's not also easy to send it to another center. So this means that even this logic, the philosophy of sending patients from small hospitals to big centers is something that is not very, is difficult to implement. So this is the other parameters that are slowing down, if you wish, the progress of medical accelerators. Nevertheless, the positive point is that there are there is a long list of tumors where you can use particle therapy, and there are some for which it is particularly successful. This is a poll made by IBA towards professionals of medicine, showing that there is a general agreement that for pediatric cancer, the particle therapy is a must. Because, why? For two reasons. First of all, because the fact that you reduce the dose in the surrounding tissues means that, for kids and children, I mean, they are much more sensitive to radiation. So really, you damage the development of cells, and so you have much more damage from conventional radiation therapy. And the second is that you reduce the probability of secondary cancer. So the fact that you have less dose deposited around your main cancer means that they will have less probability of developing another cancer maybe 10, 20 years from now. So pediatric cancers, then all what is around the brain. This is also something where there is a general agreement that for base of skull treatment, nervous system, head and neck cancer, this is something where there is a clear agreement that there is an advantage with the particle treatment. The debate is open for the type of cancers that, like the prostate cancer, that are, let's say, not close to vital organs, but nevertheless, let's say, close to organs that deserve some respect, in a sense. And this is something where there is a long debate. I mean, what are the advantages and disadvantages of particle therapy as compared to radiation therapy? So, an interesting field. If we go to the accelerators, for proton therapy, nowadays you can go on the market and buy your proton therapy accelerator. It's usually a cyclotron from three or four vendors on the market around the world, plus one vendor for synchrotrons in Japan. And you can buy your turnkey center, single room from IBA, for example, here, or multiple treatment rooms here, again, from IBA. What are the critical issues now with proton therapy? These accelerators, the cyclotrons are excellent because they are small and cheap and reliable. The problem is that it's not so easy to change the energy. Energy variability now is done by CP degraders that go into the beam, slide into the beam to change the energy. And it is something that is slow, doesn't have a high resolution, and you irradiate the degraders, which is something that makes them a bit difficult to handle afterwards. So this is something that, and also on top of that, the cyclotrons tends to be quite lossy, so they need a large shielding around the accelerator. Then I profit of this picture to show you another issue, which is the gantry. Because the point is that, physicists, I mean, it's quite normal. I mean, the easiest thing would be to move the patient in front of the beam. Well, no. So talking to the doctor is absolutely forbidden. You have to move the beam around your patient, and the patient has to lie horizontally on the couch. And this for two reasons. The first one is, of course, that usually the person is ill, and so will not so easy to ask him to stand, to be blocked somewhere, or to move him around. But second is that the treatment comes after imaging. You need to have a very good imaging of your tumor, and then you go to the treatment. And imaging is done laying on a couch. So, and when you stand, all your organs will move, and the picture is not going to be the same. So you will lose you don't get to your target if you don't have the patient. So, and which for us, from a technological point of view, it's a big challenge, because then you have to develop something that rotates around the patient and would bring with magnets your beam towards the point where you have the irradiation. And the gantry design is one of the main challenges now for the design of new machines for particle therapy. So proton therapy, so in competition with cyclotrons, you can use synchrotrons. And the synchrotrons are, for example, used at Heidelberg and at CNAU in Pavia. So you can use, and the main advantage of the synchrotron is that you can do at the same time protons and ions. Alternative solutions are based on a linear accelerator. So there is a CERN spin-off company, ADAM, that has been recently acquired by AVO, a UK company, and they are developing LIGHT, which is a compact LINAC design at high energy, 3 gigahertz, for proton therapy, which is can be in competition with cyclotrons, mainly because it allows a high repetition frequency with the pulse-to-pulse modulation of the energy. So the energy scan is very, very easy, and this type of machines have small emittance and no beam loss, and now it's a race against time for them to put together the first prototype in the next years of the complete LIGHT LINAC. There's been also a design for a compact LINAC for proton therapy that was done a few years ago at CERN using click technology, and to put the entire LINAC on the gantry. So you rotate the LINAC around the patient which is still, I mean, something which is less expensive and easier than making the Linux plus the game tree, as is the basic design. So all these designs use the RFQ as injector. It was developed at CERN, is our contribution, but I don't want to go into the details of that. I want to tell you a few words about ions. Ions are very, very interesting because they are much more effective than protons in treating tumors. Why that? Because what is the effect? So, okay, with the protons, the particles, you send your energy, and then you hit what? You hit the DNA. You have the DNA, the double helix. So you hit somewhere your DNA. You break the DNA, and then you kill the cell. Yes, but the point is that our cells are very good in repairing DNA. So, and this is why you have this double helix. You bring your spare with you, and also it's very easy, based on the spare, to reconstruct the helix. And the repair is the important mechanism, more than the killing of the DNA. I mean, so, and this is why what we have to fight against is the repair of the DNA after hitting a cancerous cell. Yes. And the good point about ions is fragmentation. So we all know that ions, they hit their target, and then they produce fragments that go everywhere. And so you have a higher probability of double-strand breaks. So to break in two positions the DNA, which is not repairable, or at least is much more difficult to repair than a single strand. So this is why ions already, by themselves, when I say ions, something heavier than protons, so usually it is used carbon. Carbon is a typical, for historical reasons, because it was the first ion to be used in Japan, is what is now used by most of therapy accelerators, it's carbon. And carbon is already the effectiveness as compared to radiation therapy is a factor of 3 for ions with respect to 1.1 for protons. On top of that, ions are effective with radio-resistant tumors. There are particular type of tumors that really they are resistant to X-rays, but you can kill them with ions. And on top of that, there are indications that the ions might also be more effective against metastasis, which is a leading cause of death more than the tumor itself. So there is a big hope for ions, but ions are much less known and used than protons. And there is an additional problem, which is mainly in the physics. The fact that, if you remember the beta block equation, so you have a factor z square on the top. So the higher the atomic number, then the energy loss is. And so you lose more energy. And to penetrate inside the body, you need more energy. So an ion accelerator has to go to higher energies than a proton accelerator. And the comparison term is Biro for us, the magnetic rigidity. So with an ion accelerator, you have to go to 440 MeV per unit, which is about a factor of 3 in magnetic rigidity as compared to protons. So Biro, so it means that if you make a synchrotron for carbon ions, either you take about 3 times higher field in the magnets, or 3 times bigger in the radius, which means 3 times more in the cost, if not more. So ion accelerators are much more expensive. And also on top of that, you see that the gantry, for example, becomes a monster. This is the high double gantry. You see those two small persons here, and this is the rotating gantry, 600 tons. So this is why, there are so few ion accelerators inside in the world. But this is a very promising avenue for improving particle therapy, as we will see later on. Particle therapy, there are many new developments that are going on. So here we have a list. For example, I want to mention pensing beam scanning that has been recently developed at PSI and is now applied to most of the particle therapy centers in the world. So you can make a small pensing beam, you can go to irradiate your beam. There are motion management. There is a lot of work on what they call four-dimensional scanning. So following the movement of tumors, because as you breathe, everything moves. And so if you can follow this movement, this is something which is possible and probably also easier with particle therapy than with radiation therapy. There is a lot of work going combining imaging with treatment, for example, to go really to solve the problem of the fact that one day you do the imaging, maybe a month later, you do the treatment and everything has changed inside the body of a person who is healed, for example. So there is a lot of work going, but this goes mainly to the delivery part. So there is a lot of work going into the delivery system, and there is not much question on the accelerator itself nowadays for proton therapy. And of course, apart compact gantries, which of course is one of the challenges for the future designer of this type of systems. Very quickly, a few words on electrons and neutrons. You can use electrons for direct treatment during operation at low energy. So you have an open wound, basically, that you can treat with electron beam. For this, you need accelerators that are at high frequency, very compact, can be moved around the surgery, during the surgery. And this is something which is used in many hospitals. Also at Geneva, I think they have just installed one of these machines. And there is people working on the use of very high energy electrons, which means 250 MeV, which you see is not a Bragg peak, the absorption of this, but this is something that goes down faster than X-rays and can be exploited for the treatment of tumors. And the idea is, again, to go to some, to look for something which is cheaper than particle therapy. But it's still under development, and there are a lot of connections with the click work, because here the challenge is to find high gradient structures that operate at high frequency that can accelerate the beam to these energies. There is still not much work nowadays with direct neutron treatment. There is work on what is called boron neutron capture therapy, and in particular there have been some interesting developments in Japan recently with an idea to inject boron 11 that is activated by a beam of neutrons and then decay inside the body. So you basically you can inject something that will become radioactive only when it is activated by a external beam of neutron. This is something which is very effective, can be very useful, for example, for treating brain tumors, and there's a lot of work going on in Japan in this respect. But from the accelerator point of view, this is another challenge, because it is something at low energy but very high current. So 3 MeV is about the energy of the accelerator, and more than 1 milliamp CW, continuous beam. So this is something that not even with ENAC4 you cannot do. I mean, it is something more, I mean, stronger, let's say, in a sense, than what you can do with ENAC4. Yes. Okay, a few slides on imaging. Imaging is also another important use of radioisotopes. Radioisotopes are produced with an accelerator that is usually a cyclotron. So you see that the idea is that, again, you produce your radioisotopes as an accelerator, then you attach a radioisotope to a chemical compound that's usually a glucose. This attachment is done in a radiotherapy, a radiopharmaceutical compound, usually just a box like this one, where there is expert people, is very good, this kind of chemistry, and you can attach a radioisotope to the glucose that you inject into the patient, and this glucose is accumulated on high metabolic activity regions, so for example, tumors and metastasis. And this then, if the patient goes to a scanner, when the radioisotope decays, then the products of the decay can be seen by an array of detectors, and you can make nice pictures either of the activities of the brain or of tumors and metastasis. And you have two ways of doing this imaging. The old way, which is called SPECT, single photon emission computed tomography, that uses technetium-99, 6 hours half-life, or you can use fluorine-18, which decays into gamma rays in opposite direction. So you can really measure the coincidence of the two gammas, and which is much more precise. So this is the PET, positron emission tomography scanning, that requires fluorine-18, 1 hour 50 half-life, attached to fluorodeoxyglucose, FDG. So, wonderful. And what is the scheme nowadays is that you produce your isotope in a accelerator center, usually a cyclotron, and then they are shipped overnight to the hospitals. And then, you see, so for fluoride-18, half-life is about 2 hours. So after 2 hours of road, you already have lost half of your isotopes. But what is important is that it is not so far the hospital where you go, so that enough material survives to go to do the treatment. So this scheme works very well in our countries where we have good roads and we have good communications, but already there are problems in using the system in countries less developed with a worse road system. This is why there is some work that is going on, and again, I'm proud that CERN has its hand on both of these activities. There is work going on developing compact accelerators to be installed in hospitals for the production of isotopes. So not to be dependent on all the logistics of shipping the isotopes from the production center. There is one project, actually they are putting together a prototype in CEMAT Madrid of a compact superconducting cyclotron for production of radioisotopes. And here CERN gave a contribution in the design of the cryogenic system. And then we have a design that we are proposing at CERN where we can use our RFQ, compact radio frequency quadrupole design, putting two RFQs one after the other to reach 10 MeV energy and to make a system that would make isotopes in the hospital where only the target here is shielded inside a sandwich of steel and borated polyethylene. What are the advantages? What would be the advantages of these systems? Not only that you can have your isotopes on demand in the hospital without having to order them a few days in advance, but also the fact that you could use different isotopes from fluoride 18, for example, carbon 11. Carbon 11, which allows a better accuracy during the imaging process and has a half lifetime of only 20 minutes. 20 minutes, so you cannot really ship it over the road, but it's something that really requires to have the production next to the machine. And on top of that, also the dose to the patient during the imaging would not be the 30 millisieverts that we have seen in the previous slides, but would be much, much lower if one would use this kind of short life isotopes. But this is something that is still, I mean, for the moment on the drawing board in the stage of prototypes. There is also some work to design alternatives for the production of technetium for SPECT tomography, because nowadays these isotopes are produced by nuclear reactors. Nuclear reactors there are few nuclear reactors in the world that produce this kind of isotopes, the technetium for the SPECT imaging, and there was a crisis in 2009 when one of the reactors had to shut down for unforeseen maintenance, others were stopped for maintenance, and there were no isotopes, no technetium in the world. The doctors had to reduce drastically all the scannings because there was a lack of radioisotopes. Now they've taken over, they are again made in the nuclear reactors, but there's a lot of work to design and develop new accelerators that would allow to have a production to produce this isotope independently from the present delivery chain based on nuclear reactors. So a lot of work, a few slides more on treatment with isotopes. So there is also a lot of interest now where many studies are devoted towards direct treatment of tumors with injected radioisotopes. So for example, you can make an alpha emitting isotope, you can attach it to a targeting vector, which can be an antibody, a peptide, something that sticks to a tumor, and then your alphas would irradiate the tumor and then really kill the tumoral cells in situ. For the moment, there is a lot of experimentation in this. This could be the only way of curing diffused cancers, metastasis, but also leukemia. And at a certain moment, for the moment, the few isotopes needed for this type of treatment, they are produced by few cyclotrons, but it might be that in the future, there will be a strong demand for this type of isotopes. For example, one could think of an accelerator to produce astatine, which is a wonderful element. You see, number 85, the rarest element on Earth, the less stable element in the periodic table, and with a half-life of 7.2 hours. And basically, to make this, you have to accelerate alphas, to send them on a bismuth target, and then you create astatine, you inject it to the patient, in such a way it accumulates on the tumor, and then it decays, becoming against bismuth, plus giving back the alpha particle that you have given to the bismuth. So, great, but you need accelerators that can count to an energy of 28 MeV and with a carat of more than 10 million. So it's quite a powerful accelerator, and it's another challenge. If this kind of techniques come out, will be a challenge to think of as an accelerator to deliver this type of alpha-emitting isotopes to the medical market. There's also more and more work now in mixing treatment and diagnostics. There is a much interesting theragnostics, which is integration of diagnostics and therapeutics, and it also consists in developing new isotopes that allow at the same time to do the imaging and the treatment. So to have a direct connection between what you see and what you do in the treatment. And there is a lot of interest. And an example is what we have seen recently, that the company called AAA, Advanced Accelerator Application, that was founded by an ex-CERN person, Stefano Buono, he recently has sold his company to Novartis for $3.9 billion cash. So, and this because he went through all the long process of thinking of a new compound, which is called Lutathera, that cures the immunotherapy, the type of cancers that have killed Steve Jobs. So this is why this is a very, very popular, let's say. And he has developed a new drug for the treatment of this cancer that can be produced by his accelerators. He went through all the tedious and expensive process for approval by the different authorities. And as soon as he has got the approval from the European drug authority, the following week he has sold to Novartis. So the problem is not only having the idea and the tools, it's only go through all the licensing process. This is what really takes time. He's been extremely brave in going through all this process. So congratulations to a former CERN person. And PIMS-2, I take 2 minutes more to tell you what is PIMS-2. PIMS-2 because there is a new interest at CERN in going in the direction of medical applications. There is new interest within our program for knowledge transfer for the benefit of medical applications that foresees that about 1 per mil of the CERN budget can go to medical accelerator activities, and this under the supervision of 5 committees. So it's not a very efficient process, but nevertheless it's better than nothing, and this would allow us to go in the direction of a new PIMS. PIMS was the proton-ion medical machine study that was done at CERN at the end of the 90s. It was a very successful study that brought to the design of a generation of medical synchrotrons. So the CNAU in Italy and in Medaustro in Austria has been built following the design of PIMS. It's been a very successful collaboration, and now the idea could we think of a PIMS-2? Yes, but 18 years later, the world of particle therapy is completely different. Now, proton therapy is industrial. The problem is on the delivery systems, on the therapy. We don't not do much on the accelerator, but there is some space for improvement in the field of ion accelerators. So this factor 3 magnetic rigidity, which is the problem, maybe we can find solutions how to approach this problem. And so we are thinking to a program where we are starting to prepare a program where we could analyze the synchrotron and go and explore different avenues that could be superconducting magnets, a new type of magnets, fast extraction, multiple ion sources, electron cooling, for example, that would allow to come to a second generation design for this type of ion machines. I don't know whether we can do it or not, and this is why next week we are going to have a workshop in Archon near to CERN, where we are calling the best experts in the world to see if really there is space for improvement for the big synchrotrons for ions after the generation of Heidelberg and CNAU. And then also there is the option to go into the LINAC direction, which is the advantage of faster pulsing and so energy adaptability. And there is already a design that was done by Ugo Amaldi's Terra, and now with the contribution of CERN and of ADAM, of a folded LINAC, accelerating beam from a carbon 6 plus ion source, that would have a footprint of only about 200 square meters to reach the 430 MeV unit that you need for ions. This is another option that can be explored in the frame of this PIMS-2. And my last slide, there is a possible also future user of these ideas, because there is interest now in building a particle therapy center in the Balkans in the frame of a new initiative that has been started by Herbig Schopper, And this is something that where they have asked to base at CERN a study group, and there are some synergies, of course, with the future BIMS too. Okay, so this is what I had to say. And conclusions, medical accelerators is a vast and promising field connected to medicine. Medicine is one of the main technology drivers of the 21st century. This is an important point. So more and more technology now is driven by medicine, more than by particle physics, I would say. There is a wide space for improvement, for exciting developments, but this is a special world. The accelerator is only part of an overall big facility which has to comply with well-defined, established procedures and rules. And thank you for your attention.
So thank you for the fantastic lecture.
Sorry for taking 1 hour.
Okay. Yeah, I think we underestimated on space and time here, looking at the, sorry for the people that are sitting down. Well, the question on everybody's mind is, where are the $3.9 billion? But we cannot ask that. So I hope people have other questions for Maurizio.
On, I think it was around slide 37, you mentioned that carbon 11 would have a better resolution in PET than fluorine. And I wanted to ask why so. And also in the same block of slides, you mentioned the overall dimension of the system to produce radioisotopes developed in collaboration with CERN. And it looked to me like there was a big emphasis on reduction of the volume or the surface needed. Yes, what will be then the room required for the rest of the procedure required to get from the isotope out of the accelerator then to a chemical that can be injected?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, good questions. Okay, question number one for carbon 11. I don't know the details, but what I know is that now we have they use fluoride 18 for everything, so one size fits them all. And instead, there is some interest in having different isotopes that are better attached to different type of tumors or objects that are under investigation. So go from one size for all to adapted imaging techniques for the type of tumors or effect that you are looking for. So this is it. And number two, the size, yes, this is one of the points. I mean, the point is that so you want to make accelerators put accelerators in a hospital, which means that your weight has to be compatible with an existing building. You don't have to make a big bunker. So the main point is that as a hospital, so the Geneva Hospital, Hôpital Cantonal, they have installed a cyclotron. They had to make a lot of space. They had to go deep underground to shield everything, which is something that usually is very difficult for hospitals. They need space that they don't have. While something which is very compact can fit in an existing hall in terms of weight and of size is something that would be more useful. The problem is that the radiopharmacy part also is not so large in terms of size, but it's going to be expensive because you need a lot. There is an investment cost in the radiopharmaceutical part that if you make a lot of isotopes, you can share over a lot of production. For a small production, this is what really the difficulty of these kind of systems is the fixed cost of setting up a radiopharmaceutical unit, complying with all the rules. Okay.
There was a question there.
Thank you very much for the lecture. So I have a question concerning the slide 32, I think it was, when you talked about the interoperational electron therapy. Yes. So when you do a surgery on tumor or metastasis, quite often the problem is the clear cut. So if you leave the dirty end, essentially the surgery is a waste of time. So is that done for this, like this interoperation?
Yes, it replaces radiation therapy for many applications. A typical case is breast cancer, where usually after remotion ablation of the tumor, they close, and then you have to go to conventional radiation therapy for months with a large dose which goes to the other tissues. Instead, when they do it for breast cancer, immediately after the surgery, with the one still open, first remotion, and then they irradiate the surrounding tissues in order to kill any possible spread of the tumor, and then they close, and it's the end of the story.
Right.
So, you go in one shot, you do all the dose in one shot directly on the area.
I see.
Yes.
But do you think it can also be used to make sure the cut is clear? Because it's quite a big problem, because it's very hard to really understand how you make a clear cut for surgeons, right?
Yes, yes. No, but I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, I'm not an expert on that, but
okay.
I don't think so. But it is more for just diffuse spreading a dose.
Okay.
I mean, around the cut.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of more questions. You're still.
So I have a question, because you had a slide on hadron therapy, which sounded to me a bit pessimistic. I don't know. I want to understand if it's pessimistic for the socioeconomic situation that it is, because it's expensive like this, or it's, if there is also something more physics-based about this. Because it's true that until 10 years ago, the quality of life was not even considered in the medical statistics. I mean, if you survived for 5 years and you were still alive, you were a great success for medicine, even if you were in a bed, completely unable to move. But there also the approach of academics is being shifting. Now we have a medical statistics department that try to qualify quality of life like this, and I mean, quality of life is not something that is negligible. So I wanted to understand if you share this view, and if it's more something related to the economic situation or more to the treatment itself.
Yes. No, okay. First of all, I didn't want to be pessimistic at all. I mean, only I wanted to give you some reasons why the spread is not so fast as one would have expected. So, and my conclusion is that it's going to take time, a long time, because of the fact of entering quality of life into the overall, analysis of a patient conditions, also of having a better economic case. I mean, if you want to start PIMS-2, is to make these machines less expensive. This is the overall goal. We all want to reduce the costs of add-on therapies compared to radiation therapy, to increase the effectiveness by studying more the effects, the delivery, and of considering the overall conditions, not only the survival rate. So I didn't want to be pessimistic, but only want to tell you that it is going to take years, like everything. I mean, so it's not that the world is not going to change tomorrow.
Okay, one more question.
Well, I had a comment exactly on this, because that slide is absolutely correct. I said that, and the cost is, I think, the most important. But there's one additional point that I would add, is that conventional radiation therapy is not standing still; it's making progress as well. So if you now, one would propose to use proton therapy using the technology 20 years ago, like, you know, passive scattering, it would lose, because now you have this arc therapy, you have tomotherapy. It's not yet on the market, but you will have image guided with linear coupled to a magnetic resonance. So, you know, the conventional side is also making a lot of progress, and you have to compare with that. With,
yes.
On top of what you list.
So there is competition.
Exactly.
Yes, the last one was not a question. Let's take one more question before lunch. Anything there? Anything else?
Always talking about hadron therapy, and in particular heavy ion therapy. What I've heard said many times is that fragmentation, it has benefits through its effects on the helix of the DNA, but it can also somehow smear this Bragg peak, and in a way that is difficult to control. Can this somehow also be a killer for this kind of therapy, or is there a margin to improve? Is it a field where particle and nuclear physicists can still help, for example?
Yes, I think so, because also the reason why we want to focus PIMS-2 on ions is that we believe there is a lot of work to be done in ion therapy, also in the delivery system, and studying how the dose is distributed, study this fragmentation. I don't know how much particle physics could contribute, but definitely are welcome to participate in the work. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.